Good morning. Good morning to you, and welcome. Welcome to Covenant Presbyterian Church. My name is Italo Furieri. I am the pastor here at Covenant. We are so glad that you are here. And it is in the name of the Lord Jesus, who is the Lord, the head of the church, the king of this house, which is made of living stones. Let me turn my alarm off here. Hold on. He is the king of this house, and he is the one who welcomes you to be here with us. So if you are a visitor with us, there are some visitor cards for you in the back. And you put your name in there, and you drop it in the offering plate when he comes by, then we will have a record of your attendance here so that we can know that you are here, know your name, and follow up with you. But in that card, you also have in the back a place for prayer requests. And if you put a prayer request there and drop it in the offering plate, that prayer card is going to find its way to me and to our elders here, and we will pray for you. So please keep that in mind as well. And without any further then, let me invite you to prepare for worship. There is a passage from Scripture printed for you there in the cover of your worship guide. Let us prepare to worship God. Stand for the call to worship. The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Who shall ascend the mountain of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully, he will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts, leads. Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is the commander of the armies of the Lord. He is the one who has bought us with his own blood and has freed us from the darkness and the dominion of Satan. He's the one who has washed our sins away. He is the one who has brought us here to join your heavenly host and adore you, that your spirit may be in our midst, just as your Son promised us he would be. We pray these things, even with that prayer which your Son himself taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, let us praise God then and sing, Holy, Holy, Holy.
He does not keep silent. Before him is a devouring fire, around him a mighty tempest. He calls to the heavens above and to the earth that he may judge his people. Gather to me a faithful ones who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. The heavens declares righteousness, for God himself is the judge. And Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus, who covers us with his righteous robe and atones for us and stands at the right hand advocating for your people. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. I will be confessing our faith today from the Westminster Shorter Catechism. What offices does Christ execute as our Redeemer?
Christ as our Redeemer executes the offices of prophet, priest, and of king, both in his estate of humiliation and exaltation.
How does Christ execute the office of a priest?
Christ executes the office of a priest in his once offering up of himself, a sacrifice to satisfy divine justice and reconcile us to God, and making continual intercession for us.
And now let's continue to praise God with our next song, Now We Think We All Are God. Thank you. service to bring our prayers and petitions to our Almighty. So let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for your Son, Christ Jesus, who has redeemed us and now stands at your right hand advocating for your beloved. So it is with this assurance that we bring our prayers and our petitions to you. For in humblest we ask that you please hear us now as we pray for the needs of your people. Lord, we pray for the persecuted church around the world where many of your people live and work in extremist countries. Today, however, we pray specifically for the church in Nigeria, our brothers and sisters. They're no strangers to persecution. They have violent attacks even in their churches, Lord. We pray that you protect them. We pray that you provide much needed medical and material assistance. Please replace the Bibles that have been destroyed by these Muslim extremists and the provision of ministry tools for frontline gospel workers, reaching Muslims for Christ. Lord, we know that you will have the victory. Lord, we pray for our nation, which was founded by Christian principles, which many were made by God-fearing men. May these type of men be restored as we pray for more believers to be led to run for office and help build a bulwark against those that are legislating evil. We pray for our church here in the RGV that you will strengthen us with your love and hope, and not to be discouraged, but to finish the race set before us. Lord, send us more elders and deacons to help guide your church. And may your Holy Spirit be with us as we navigate through this world, and may we be a hope and a beacon to those who are hopeless. For your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Lord, we pray specifically for Miss Helen Barbie, who is in the hospital, who fell and broke her hip and has gone through surgery. May her recovery be quick, for Lord, you are the great physician. We trust that healing will begin, and for whatever your will be done, let it be done in that situation. Lord, give Pastor Italo the words to help guide with the guidance of the Holy Spirit to bring truth to your people on this your day. Amen.
Joyful occasion for us today. We have a baptism. It's a very sacred moment for us. I can see the boy over there. I'll invite you guys up in a second. First, let me say a few words. So this is a very important, it's a solemn moment in the life of Warren Beckham Hillman. Because today, what is happening here, what's about to happen here, is that God is going to formally declare Warren's relationship with the church and with himself. God is going to show Warren that God has a relationship with him as his heavenly father. That's what's about to happen. Because Warren was born to believing parents, God sets him apart as his own through the sacrament of baptism. Now, the word sacrament, what does that word mean? The word sacrament means something visible that you can see, which God sets apart as sacred to signify and seal an invisible and spiritual reality. So let me quickly reflect on what Scripture teaches about baptism. Baptism is not a sign or seal given by Christians to God. Baptism is a sign and a seal that God gives to his people. It is a sign and seal God is giving, not the other way around. We are the ones who receive signs from God. If you remember in Scripture, God gave Abram a sign. So in Genesis chapter 15, God tells Abram to apply the sign of the covenant to all his children and everyone in his household. It was the sign of circumcision. In that occasion, Abram's name is also changed to Abraham. God is the one who is guiding this. He is the one who's giving Abram a sign. And he completes that sign by even changing his name and calling him Abraham. Who is giving the sign to whom? God is the one who's giving the sign. It's a lot like a wedding. If you guys ever been to a wedding, you know that there comes a moment when the officiating pastor, the officer who's marrying this couple, he asks the husband, the groom, he asks the groom, what sign of your love do you give this woman? And then he says, a ring. Now I want you to imagine this scene. If the bride then says, no, here's how we're going to do this. You are not going to give me a sign. I am the one who's going to give you a sign by putting the ring on my finger. We know that that's not what happens. What happens is she receives that sign. She receives that ring. He puts it on her finger. That's what baptism is. It's a sign that God is giving you. It's a sign that God has given you, and it's a sign that God is giving Warren and his parents this morning. Just like the giving of the ring at a wedding, Warren is going to receive this sign. Now, baptism is not just a sign. It's also a seal. It's a seal. When a king seals a document, and what is in view here is a king with a signet ring, and he stamps a document with his seal. When a king does that, what he is saying is that he is promising to fulfill the conditions of this document, of this covenant. And baptism acts in the same way. All of those who receive the seal of God, they have a right claim to all the promises of what that seal is signifying. Those who receive the seal of baptism, they are able to turn to God through faith in Christ and thereby claim. They will make a claim. I've received the sign and the seal of the promises you made to me. It's time for me to receive them. All the promises are now mine. So it is both a sign and a seal of the promises of God, which have been fulfilled by whom already? By Christ. So what's happening here is very solemn and sacred, because in a visual manner, God is speaking. God is speaking. It is a visible representation of an invisible and spiritual reality. The sacrament of baptism is administered by the church, always in obedience to the commands of Christ. And the command of Christ is that all nations should be converted, baptized, and taught that Jesus Christ is the Lord. Baptism then signifies, in other words, it represents, it shows forth. Baptism reveals and seals our union with Christ, both in his death and resurrection. It signifies and seals the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. It signifies and seals the new birth or regeneration, which is the work of the Holy Spirit alone. It signifies and seals adoption as children. And it signifies and seals the cleansing from sins, which is why water is such a fitting symbol. By baptism, Warren and anyone who's baptized is officially admitted into the covenant community, the church, the assembly, and they are made members of the body of Christ. Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 29 say this: You are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who are baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So, in this way, what Scripture affirms is that baptism is a sign of the work that God is doing in saving his people for himself, to be his own treasured possession through Jesus Christ. And today, he makes this promise to Cole, to Emily, and to Warren. God is saying, you are my people, and I am your God. The mode that we use, you know, there's no baptistry here. There's no big tub of water. The mode we use is sprinkling, or the pouring of water. And we do it this way because the primary purpose of baptism is to signify and seal the outpouring of the regenerating and cleansing Holy Spirit. And Scripture affirms and confirms that the Spirit has been poured out on all creation. These waters that are in the baptistry there, there's nothing magic about them. They don't really, what is not happening right now is the water is not washing away Warren's sins. That's not what's happening. But here's what the water does signify. That even now, even right now, Warren does have guilt. Even now, he is sinful. That's what the water does demonstrate to you. Warren doesn't get a free pass. The water doesn't wash his sins away. But the water does declare to Warren and to all of you that those who are baptized, if they come to Christ by faith, if Warren believes in Jesus as his parents have believed before him, Warren will have his sins washed away by that which the water signifies, the blood of Christ poured out for the forgiveness of his sins. He is in a covenant relationship with God. And if he calls upon, if he makes the claim through Christ that those benefits of the covenant are his, he will have them. God is saying that to him beyond doubt with this sign. That's what baptism does. That's what he represents. One day, the time is going to come for Warren when he will have obligations in this covenant that God is entering with him in today. Warren will have to believe. He will have to repent of his sins. He will have to obey the word of God. Warren will have to make a public confession of faith. And as a church member, Warren will also be a beneficiary of the discipline of the church, of the shepherding of the church. Faith, not the water, is the only instrument of salvation. It is the only instrument of justification from sins, is faith. This baptism will not effect or realize regeneration. This baptism will seal Warren as a member in the visible church. And this baptism is placing on Warren, on his parents, and on you, and on everyone who's been baptized here, a very strong imperative, a command. What is that command that this baptism is placing on all of us here? It's placing this command, listen, love Jesus. Love Jesus. Believe the gospel. Love his people. Live by faith alone. Live by faith alone. That's what God is doing in the baptism. He's preaching the gospel to Warren, to his parents, to you. Therefore, what do we conclude? Is the water a substitute for faith? No, it is not a substitute for faith. We see the baptism of children, the children of believers, not just any children, but the children of believers. We see the baptism of children of believers in continuity and in correspondence with the Old Testament sign of circumcision, which has now been expanded to all nations. And, girls, look at me. And to you, to girls, right? Girls did not used to be circumcised. They couldn't. But now, through Christ, they are baptized. What a blessing. The family of God has expanded. And why do we think that there's a correspondence between circumcision and baptism? Because the Apostle Paul wrote this. Look what Paul wrote in Colossians chapter 2. Paul says this: "In him also you were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ." What is the circumcision of Christ then? "Have been buried with him in baptism." That's what it is. Circumcision of Christ is now baptism. "In which you were also raised with him through faith in the powerful working of God who raised him from the dead." So this is what we're doing. This is what's happening now. So I want to invite the Hillmans to come forward. And as the Hillmans come forward here, if you are baptized, I want you to remember that this that we're doing here is what your baptism. So look at me. Every one of you have been baptized, children, teenagers. If you are baptized, this is what your baptism shows to you, that all that Jesus did belongs to you, and it is yours. If you believe Christ, through faith in Christ, all the promises are yours. In the sacrament, you were called to live by his grace, not of anything you could merit, but because he loved you while you were still a sinner and called you his own. What is Warren doing today? Nothing. What does anyone do that deserves salvation? Nothing. God could not preach the gospel to you any more clearer than that. In this sacrament, God is making a promise to this child. He's putting his mark on him. What happened to you on your baptism is God fixed his eyes on you. This morning, God is fixing his eyes on Warren. That's right. And by his Holy Spirit, the Lord will bless Warren. The Lord will pursue Warren as a member of this church. And even now, God, right now, what God is doing is he's calling Warren to himself. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, Paul says and affirms that the children of believers are holy. They are set apart. They are not like the children of all the other people. The promises made to believers and to their children, all of those who are far off. Some of you might be thinking, okay, what benefit is there in receiving a baptism now and becoming a member of the church now? Besides the fact that it clearly preaches the gospel to us in a visible way, here's what Warren's life is going to be like as a member of the church. He's going to hear the gospel constantly. He's going to experience God's grace in a way that those who are outside of our church, they do not. And one day, when Warren is older, Warren is going to come to his parents. His Warren is going to come to me. He's going to come to you. And he's going to ask this question: how may I know that God loves me? And his parents, and I, and the elders here, and all of you, you're going to say, this is what you're going to say: I saw God place his sign and his seal on you. He set you apart as his own. Look to Jesus, Warren. Set your eyes upon Jesus. Lay hold of all the promises which are yours in Christ Jesus. You're going to be able to say that. To him. All of you. That's what happened to you. And that's what's being repeated to you this morning through this. Which is, by the way, why we do baptisms in worship. Because it belongs to us. It's a sign of God to us. It is not a private sign to be done somewhere else where we don't all participate of this blessing. And this is what we are about to do. One day we're going to be able to tell Warren, without any reservation, we're going to be able to say, Warren, do not despise your birthright. It is your birthright. Believe Christ, and it's yours. So parents, God is calling you to teach this child to read to him the word of God. God is calling you to instruct this child in the principles of the faith from scripture and from our confession of faith. God is calling you to pray for Warren and with Warren. God is calling you to set an example in following Christ, especially that you should bring him to church, that you should bring him here, that he may hear the word of God preach, that he may receive the signs and seals of the covenant. So come to worship every Sunday. Commit to this. All of you parents, all of you Christians, all of you, commit to this, because the promise is for you and for your children. God says, I will establish my covenant between you and me and your seed after you, throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto you and to your seed after you. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household. I think our culture has spurned childbearing as the ordinary means of disciple making. Do you understand that? Today, God is calling these parents to say, disciple this child. The promise is for you and for him, that if you disciple him, this is the ordinary means of growth of the church. I love making disciples who aren't born in the church. But this is the ordinary way. Let's not spurn that. It is what God is telling us. Therefore, parents, I have some vows here for you to take. I'm going to ask you these questions, and then when I finish them, you answer with I do, with we do, okay? So, Cole, Emily, do you acknowledge your child's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you claim God's covenant promises in Warren's behalf, and do you look in faith to your Lord Jesus Christ for his salvation as you do for your own? Do you now unreservedly dedicate your child to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before him a godly example, that you will pray with and for him, and that you will teach him the doctrines of our holy religion, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring him up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? And now, Covenant, Presbyterian Church, I have a question for you. So pay attention, because you need to answer this question too. He's becoming a member of you. So here's the question. Answer we do when I finish asking. Do you, as a congregation, undertake the responsibility of assisting the parents in the Christian nurture of this child?
We do.
Well, then let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come near to you as your people, as your family. And we thank you for the treasure that you have given us in Warren. Lord, as he's covered by the waters of baptism, we recognize that there is no magic happening this moment, because only the blood of Jesus can cleanse his sins. But we do believe that through these waters of baptism, the Holy Spirit is formally welcoming him as a member of your covenant family. So we ask you humbly, in this special moment, that you would begin a supernatural work in Warren's heart. Lord, that you would join to this outward baptism of water the inward baptism of your Holy Spirit. That you would pursue Warren with steadfast love and power so that Warren will be born again and confess Jesus Christ as his Lord. That this child would have union with Christ in the death and resurrection of Christ. Lord, make this baptism a seal of his adoption, of his remission of sin, of his new birth, of eternal life, and all the other promises which are ours in the covenant of grace through Jesus Christ. Do it, Lord, for your glory, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Can I hold this one?
Yes, buddy, let's do this.
Thanks for what just happened, and we ask you that you may make what just happened here effectual. We know you will. We know you will. Lord, you did say, let the little children come to me. Lord, we are not going to hinder them. Would you have mercy on us as we endeavor to continue to preach the gospel to Warren and also to one another. We put all our hope and expectation in you, that you are going to be true to your promises and to your gospel. Lord, we pray and give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. I know for a fact he did better than some of you would have done up here. Well, with that, let us, as we have seen, such a remarkable sign of the fact that we need the cleansing blood of Christ because of our sins. Let us confess our sins together with a prayer that is there in your worship guide. I'm going to read, and then we're going to pray together. Beloved in the Lord, since we see in God's commandments as in a mirror how serious and manifold our sins are, for which we deserve temporal and eternal punishment, let us wholeheartedly confess the same to our faithful Father. Let us pray. I, a poor sinner, confess before you, my God and Creator, that I have sinned gravely and in many ways against you, not only with outward and clear sins, spiritual blindness, unbelief, slowness of heart, doubts, impatience, pride, evil, greed, secret envy, hatred, and jealousy, as well as other evil emotions. You, my Lord and God, recognize this in me very well, but sadly, I cannot recognize them sufficiently. I feel sorrow and regret for them and wholeheartedly desire grace through your dear Son, Jesus Christ. Beloved, now, in silent confession, take your sins particularly before God. Never leaves us without assurance of forgiveness. In the book of Hebrews, we read, and every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us. For after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds." Then he adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Beloved, let us stand and respond to such a great assurance of pardon. And let's sing from Psalm 103. Bless the Lord. Yes, and let me remind you, there's two pages, okay? The first page has the entire first three verses. When we finish the third verse, you're going to turn your page, and we're going to sing the other three verses of the hymn, okay? So let's sing Psalm 103.
Lord, a soul and all within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, my soul, forget not all his blessings to proclaim.
chapter 17, as we continue in the book of Numbers. Book of Numbers, chapter 17, we're going to start on verse 12. In the previous two chapters, in the previous passage, 16 and 17, what happened there was Korah's rebellion. Korah's rebellion could be illustrated by this popular 18th century proverb. You guys have heard this before. This is the proverb: fools rush in where angels fear to tread. You know, the symbol of the Holy of Holies was the Ark. And on the top of the Ark of the Covenant, you had two angels hiding their faces from the refulgent, brilliant, stupendous, marvelous holy glory of the Lord. But Korah and all of those who rebelled with him, what they wanted is that they wanted to make themselves the priests and to the Holy of Holies. In other words, they were like fools treading where even angels feared to tread. And on that day, God, on that rebellion, God gave them a very clear demonstration of judgment and of his power. He sent a plague and fire from heaven, and approximately 15,000 people died because of that. 15,000 people. And Aaron interceded for them. And then God gave the people a sign showing that Aaron's priesthood will always be for you a sign of life and fruitfulness. Because Aaron's staff, if you remember, Aaron's dad's stick blossomed into a fruitful tree. So they are always going to forever be able to come near to God through the priesthood of Aaron. They can always draw near to God. And then the question is, how did the people respond to the signs that God gave them that day? I think their response, as we're going to read here, their reaction might sound familiar to you. Maybe you have done that before in your life. They answered with this question: are we all to perish? So let's pray, and then we're going to read. Heavenly Father, we ask you for your blessing upon now the reading and the preaching of your holy word, that your spirit might open your eyes and our minds for these wonderful things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So starting on verse 12, we're going to read chapter 17 from verse 12 to chapter 18 to verse 7, okay? And the people of Israel said to Moses, "Behold, we perish. We are undone. We are all undone. Everyone who comes near to the tabernacle of the Lord will die. Are we all to perish?" Therefore, the Lord said to Aaron, "You and your sons and your father's house with you shall bear iniquity connected with the sanctuary, and you and your sons with you shall bear iniquity connected with your priesthood. And with you bring your brothers also, the tribe of Levi, the tribe of your father, that they may join you and minister to you while you and your sons with you are before the tent of the testimony. They shall keep guard over you and over the whole tent, but shall not come near to the vessels of the sanctuary or to the altar, lest they and you die. They shall join you and keep guard over the tent of meeting for all the service of the tent, and no outsider shall come near you. And you shall keep guard over the sanctuary and over the altar, that there may never again be wrath on the people of Israel. And behold, I have taken your brothers, the Levites, from among the people of Israel. They are a gift to you, given to the Lord, to do the service of the tent of meeting. And you and your sons with you shall guard your priesthood for all that concerns the altar and that is within the veil. And you shall serve. I give your priesthood as a gift, and any outsider who comes near you shall shall be put to death. Thus the reading of the word of Lord, of the Lord. So when the people were confronted with God's wrath, with his power, and with the judgment of God, they give us this response, which let me propose to you that this is a familiar response. We've seen this before, which is a response that is correct, but only in part. It's only partially correct. Yes, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. But what they did here is that they went from one extreme to another. Look at verse 12 again. And the people of Israel said to Moses, "Behold, we perish. We are undone. We are all undone. Everyone who comes near, everyone who comes near to the tabernacle of the Lord will die. Are we all to perish?" So what happened here is that they went from being fools who rush in where angels fear to tread, to being fools who despair of all hope, even that which was given to them through the high priest by the mercies and graces of God. They despair of all hope. They are correct in now being fearful of the Lord. They fear the Lord now. But they are wrong in that they lost all hope of nearness to God. They lost all hope that there is, in fact, one way by which they can come near to God, where they will have life instead of death or perishing. I think that the problem here is that for whatever reason, they will not come through the priesthood. They lost all hope. One of my favorite preachers, he explains it this way. He says, the transition from pride to despair is very common. Just before, they would be priests. But now, they will not come anywhere near the tabernacle, even though it was their duty to bring their sacrifices to the very door of it. So it is so often with us. Now, if you like to take notes, there's a handout in the back with some blanks for you. And your first blank is the end of this quote that I was reading to you. It's your first blank, and it says this: before we are convinced of sin, we cast off all fear of God's judgment. And when convinced, we put away all hope of his mercy. Let it not be thus. So in their response, they went from not being afraid of God at all to total despair of drawing near to God, even though God showed them the way to draw near. God provided them a mediator. So what they did was they went from misunderstanding God one way only to fall into another way of misunderstanding God. The obvious answer to their question in the passage is what? No. They ask, are we all to perish? No. No, of course not. No way. So, here's your next blank. To turn us from despair, what does God give us? What does God give them to turn them from despair? What does God give us that shall turn us from despair? Here's your next blank. The gospel. The gospel. Now, of course, here is a book of the law. It's the book of Numbers. What we have here are commands and ordinances. But it is the gospel. It is the gospel in shadow form. It is the gospel typified. It is the gospel in type. One of my favorite theologians, he lived in the 16th century, he said this: the law points with the finger to what the gospel signifies. Or in other words, the gospel points with the finger to what the law shadow under types. When the whole law is spoken of, the gospel differs from the law only in respect of clearness of manifestation. Let me explain to you what's happening here. Jesus, when he comes, he shines a very bright light in the gospel that's preached to you right here in the law. The law was never meant to be the way of salvation, but it was always meant to be the proclamation of the only way of salvation from beginning to end, which is now made clear in whom? Christ. And the question for us then is this: look, do you want to come near to God? Do you want to approach God? Do you want to have close fellowship with God? Appear in his presence. Pray to him and feel as though your prayer gets to his throne room. Do you want that in your life? I know I do. I want closeness with God. I want to rest under the shadows of his wings. I want nearness with God. But perhaps like you, I too feel the tug of these two rebellions. The tug of these two rebellions. Either thinking that I can approach God in any way I want, in any cavalier, irreverent way. A lot like my culture. I live in a place where people think they can approach God in any way they want. Anyway. And I go from that to thinking, my sins are so terrible as to be completely disqualifying of any nearness, any hope of nearness to God, that if I approach God, I will die. But I want nearness with God, and what God gives his people here is what? The gospel. The gospel. So let's look at it. Let's look at the gospel in this passage. So here's your next blank. The high priest who bears all guilt. It's on verse 1. On verse 1, look at it again. So the Lord said to Aaron, you and your sons and your father's house with you shall bear iniquity connected with the sanctuary. Shall bear the guilt connected with the sanctuary. You and your sons with you shall bear iniquity connected with your priesthood. So here's what this means. Aaron and his descendants are the high priestly family. If anyone comes close to the sanctuary who's not supposed to be there, Aaron and his sons will be the guilty ones. That's what it's saying. If Aaron and his sons neglect the duties of their priesthood in any way, it's their fault, and they will bear the guilt. They will perish. That's what it's saying right there. For example, here's an example of how that would work, okay? The people who lived right immediately in the perimeter of the tabernacle were the Levites. If a Levite who was not specifically from the clan of Aaron tried to enter the tabernacle, Aaron and his sons were to stop them by any means necessary. If they don't stop them, just like we read on verse 3 there, the encroacher, the invader, and the priests will die. That's what it says. Can you see this scene? I want you to see this scene. A Levite just wakes up one morning and he's just hell-bent into entering the tabernacle, okay? Aaron and his sons are to tackle him, block him, stab him, whatever it takes to stop this man from entering. Any means necessary. If they don't, here's what's going to happen. That person will be damned, and they will die. They will bear the guilt. Not such a glamorous job anymore, is it? I mean, this is a very tough job. The people wanted this job. God has just taken away all the glamour from this job. illustration of what Aaron and his sons are is a lightning rod. You guys know what a lightning rod is? If you don't, children, look at me. You wanna learn this if you don't know what a lightning rod is yet. Lightning rod is a device. It's a rod. It's like an antenna, okay? But it's not an antenna. It's a lightning rod that we put on top of tall buildings. I grew up in the city with tall buildings. And the buildings around my house, they had lightning rods. A lightning rod is our best application of what we learn of the laws of physics and electromagnetism to attract, listen, to attract lightning to it. The lightning rod attracts lightning to it so that when the lightning hits, for example, a cell phone tower, it doesn't destroy the tower. It hits the lightning rod, then there is a cable that connects all the way from the lightning rod on the top to the ground. The electricity of the lightning runs through the lightning rod to the ground and dissipates on the earth. The lightning rod is between the fury, the wrath of the lightning, and everything that's in the building and all the goods and all the stuff that you want to protect. That's what Aaron, that's what the priesthood does. That's the job of the priests. From time to time, lightning rods, they need to be replaced. Actually, I think if they get hit once, you need to go check because it might have been destroyed. And you replace it. It's a deadly job. Deadly. It's an uncomfortable job. It's the job of bearing iniquity connected to the sanctuary and to the priesthood. Gotta do it perfectly. Now, do you see here a clear picture of Jesus? It's a clear picture. This is what Jesus has done. He is the one who bears the iniquity connected to the sanctuary and with the priesthood. And here's how this happened. From Adam and Eve to you, to us, we have entered the Lord's presence however we wanted. We haven't entered his presence perfectly, not once. Someone had to bear that guilt so that it wouldn't be you or I. Jesus came to bear that guilt. He bears all the iniquity for that. He came and he reveals himself as the one through whom you can enter God's presence without being stricken by lightning. But then he died because someone had to pay for all of the wrong ways that people have tried to enter into God's presence. For example, talking to spirits, praying to dead people, going to the tarot cards, necromancers, witchcraft, people trying to get into the presence of God by however ways they want. If those people repent, who will pay for the encroachment of God's presence? Jesus. They have to repent and go through Christ. There's no other way but a lightning rod. Jesus came, and beyond doubt, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And then he died. So that us, who at one time couldn't care less of how to enter God's presence rightly, entered without fear and any reverence, so that we could repent of that and not be afraid to die, but to go through Christ and enter God's presence. Next, look at the gospel in this next blank of yours there. The brothers of the high priest participating in the work. Starting on verse 2, look at verse 2 again. And with you bring your brothers also. With you bring your brothers. The tribe of Levi, the tribe of your father, that they may join you and minister to you while you and your sons with you are before the tent of the testimony. So Aaron is to bring the other Levites from the other clans. And what they're going to do is they're going to join Aaron in the work. They are his brothers, right? They are from the same tribe. So it's not as though Aaron is going to do the work alone. All the Levites are going to participate in this work, all of them. How exactly are the Levites going to participate in this work? Look at verse 3. They will keep guard over you and over the whole tent while Aaron and his sons work. All the Levites keep watch. They shall not come near to the vessels of the sanctuary or to the altar lest they and you die. They shall join you and keep guard over the tent of meeting for all the service of the tent, and no outsider will come near you, and you will keep guard over the sanctuary and over the altar, that there may never again be wrath on the people of Israel. So if a Levite tries to encroach, Aaron and his sons need to stop them. But if anyone else tries to encroach, to come into the Lord's presence, other than by the appointed means of the priesthood, who steps in? The Levites. The Levites step in. They are going to work with Aaron to do this work. So they help protect the Israelites at large. They help protect the Israelites at large. And you can see once again this scene. If let's say one of the tribes, you know, let's say the tribe of Asher just tries to invade the tabernacle. First, they're going to have to go to the Levites. The Levites are going to try to stop them. And I imagine that, you know, this event starts with something like this. Guys, don't do this. Starts with preaching and teaching. You don't have to do, don't do this. You want to come near God? You need to come through the high priest. And if that fails, then they do whatever is necessary to stop them, lest everyone dies, lest another plague breaks out. To further illustrate this, what are the Levites doing? Are they trying to ruin everyone's fun? Are they trying to ruin their day? No. There was an evangelist that I really like. He tells this story. He really liked the beach and the coast, so he goes to Australia with a friend. And when he is there, it's just this sunny, gorgeous day. The water is just crystal clear and beautiful. He's like, I got to get in the water. So he takes his clothes off to get in the water. And as he's about to jump in, his friend who came with him says, mate, what are you doing? What are you doing? I was like, I'm going to get in the water. Did you not see the sign right there? And the sign says, danger, sharks. Of course, he says, oh, come on, man, you'll be fine. He says, well, hundreds of people have died in these waters by shark attack. So listen, you need to decide. Is that sign over there trying to ruin your fun or just trying to save your life? You decide. So he sat there for a little bit and he put his clothes back on. Well, that's what the Levites do. They're not trying to ruin the Israelite fun. They're trying to save their lives by keeping watch. They keep watch of the tabernacle and of Aaron as Aaron does his work. Now, in this particular narrative, if Aaron is a type of Jesus, where do these guys fit in? Where do these brothers of the high priest fit in? I guess a good question for you to ask is, did Jesus ever call you or I brothers? As a matter of fact, he did. One of the passages when that clearly happens is in Hebrews, but one of the passages where that happens also very clearly is this, that those whom he foreknew is Romans 8. Those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. We are his brothers. In the book of Hebrews, connected to his high priestly work, the Father is saying that he appointed Jesus so that through him he could bring in many sons. And then the author of Hebrews says this about Jesus. This is why Jesus was not ashamed to call them brothers. Who is Jesus calling brothers? You and I. He brings us in as brothers, which can only mean one thing then. we need to keep guard somehow. Somehow we do this work of keeping guard of the sanctuary and of the priesthood. How do we do that? Of course, the work of the church does that. Everything we do and say here points to one thing, that anyone who would want to come close to God, they can. There is a way, but they must come through the priesthood. What about you personally, in your life? In your life, you are to keep guard too. You have a message to give people. You have a way of pointing to the protection of the sanctuary. Not because God needs, not because Jesus needs any protection, because he's distracted with his labor. No. It's because if anyone tries to come to the Father except through Christ, the wrath of God will be upon them. Isn't that what that passage says? That there is one who bears the wrath of God. There is one who can bear his wrath for people who want to approach God. What is your job then? You join Jesus. Join Jesus in this work as his brother and start telling people, you can come to God, but you cannot come to God except through Christ. Do you want to draw near to God? There is no other religion. There is nothing else out there. There is no other hope through which you can come to Christ. Oh, sorry, to God, except Christ. You keep guard. You keep watch. You let everything in your life and everything you say in your life do their work. And then part of your work now is to figure it out in your life specifically what that looks like. What does that look like in your life specifically? And the work of the church here can help you in that. That's why we try to make disciples here. That's why we have Sunday school. That's why we teach you the Word of God. That's why we teach you how to tell others your testimony, so that you can keep guard. It is your job. And in that job, you have this other thing about the gospel here. What else do we see about the gospel? Look at this next. God's perspective of you and of his high priest. God's perspective of you and of his high priest. That's your next blank. So in the context of coming near to God through a mediator, in that context, hear the passage. In the context of coming near to God through a mediator, through a high priest, what is God's perspective of you if you stand in for the Levites and of his high priest? It's on verse 6. Look at verse 6. Starting on verse 6. First, his perspective of you. And behold, I have taken your brothers, the Levites, from among the people of Israel. They are a gift to you, given to the Lord to do the service of the tent of meeting. Do you know what the word for gift there in the Hebrew is? Do you know what it means? Gift. It's a gift. It's valuable. It's treasured. It's purchased. It's wrapped nice and pretty. It's a gift. And do you see what it just said here? God is saying, Aaron, the Levites are my gift to you. Which is just like saying, church, people, the Father is saying to you, you are my gift to my son. Do you understand how that works? The Father bought you at the cost of his son and presented you as a gift to his son. Did the son want you? Of course he did. Because he willingly died for you so that he could have you as a gift from the Father. Now, do you see what that does for you, for the people here? They went from thinking nothing of themselves to now they are a gift. Of course, they used to think everything of themselves, right? They used to think everything of themselves. But then they went from that to thinking, we are nothing. No, but you are not nothing. If you believe in Christ, if you come to God through the high priest, you are loved. You are a gift with a purpose. You are a gift to Jesus. Let that sink in your I'm saying this to you because sometimes it doesn't sink into my head. I am a gift to Jesus in the work that he is doing. This is amazing. But that's what he's saying. The Levites, do you understand who the Levites are? It's not, these guys are not like, it's not like they never committed any sin. Their history is full of sins. And these guys are the gifts to the high priest. But of course, they can only be the gifts of the high priest because what is God's perspective of his high priest? And it's on verse 7. Look at verse 7 now. You and your sons with you shall guard your priesthood for all that concerns the altar and that is within the veil, and you shall serve. Well, if Jesus is the better and new Aaron, where is Jesus now? Jesus is beyond the veil. Is he working for you as the high priest? Absolutely he is. He's interceding for you. He is reigning for you as your king. He's doing a ton of work beyond the veil. You can't see him, but he is there. And what is he to you? Continue in the verse. And you will. And he's serving. He is the Lord's servant, right? And then God says, I give your priesthood as a gift. And any outsider who comes near shall be put to death. His priesthood is a gift. To whom? To you. To me. To the people. To all of those who want to come near through him. Anyone who would approach God through the work of the priest, they can come near to God. And in Christ, that is so much, that is so powerful. Because Aaron, he was a man. In Jesus, when you come to Jesus to come near God, you are in fact coming near to God because he is God. He is the Son of God. He is one with the Father. He's given you his Spirit. You have nearness with God in Christ. And when you come through him, that last part there, it's never going to be true of you because you are a gift to him. You are not an outsider. Because if you were, then you would die. This is the gospel. When people despair of coming near to God, which might have been you, which might have been people that you know in your life, what they need to hear is the gospel. They need to hear that, yes, your sins are great. You should fear God. But you should not despair of coming near to God. That's the whole ministry of Jesus. That's the whole ministry of Jesus. Is to be your lightning rod. So that you can become wise. And not a fool. That you would tread where even angels fear to tread. No, you come through Christ. That's what you do. When you begin to despair of drawing near to God. Let's pray. Oh, let me give you your last blank so that you don't, you know, some of you who are obsessive compulsive, you have a good day. God's perspective of Jesus is that he is a gift to you, and his perspective of you is that you are a gift to Jesus. All of that wrapped into the work of the high priest. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for such a display of your grace towards us. That we who once dared to treat your presence as if it was something to be trifled with or something that we shouldn't have reverence in. We all did that once, Lord. But now, through your Son, Jesus Christ, we do come and enter. Even as the Israelites were able to enter through Aaron. But we must come through him, Lord. It is abundantly clear that that is the case. Would you please help us to grow in our knowledge of that, but also in our understanding of our work as those who keep guard. We know the way of nearness with God. We can tell others, do not come to God without Jesus, or you will perish. We are not all to perish, but we are all to come to God through Christ and to experience this life of being gifts to him and of having him as a gift to us. Lord, help us to live in such a way. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Let us stand and respond to the preaching of the gospel. And let us sing this hymn, join all the glorious names. Please stand and sing.
Jesus, our great high priest, offered his blood and died. My guilty conscience seeks to sacrifice beside his powerful blood. Did once atone and now it pleads before the throne. Thou art my counselor, my pattern and my guide, and thou my shepherd art, O keep me near thy side, nor let my feet e'er turn astray to wander in the crooked way. Savior and my Lord, my conqueror and my King, thy scepter and thy sword, thy reigning grace I sing. Thine is the power. Behold, I sit in willing bond beneath thy feet.
And we continue worshiping with the giving of tithes and offerings and obedience and in thanksgiving to God for his gifts to us. So let's look at some of the things that you help support. We have the men's Bible study coming up this coming Saturday. So next Saturday, first Saturday of the month, men's Bible study right here at Covenant Presbyterian Church, 8:30 a.m., If you are a visitor with us, or if you don't know that you feel that you know, if you feel as though you don't know people here at Covenant, the men's Bible study is a good opportunity for you to meet the man here at Covenant. We come, get together here, and eat some tacos and drink some coffee, and then I will teach a Bible study. So come next Saturday, 8:30 a.m., right here at Covenant Presbyterian Church. Communion Sunday is next Sunday, so next Sunday, we're going to eat the Lord's Supper together, and following the Lord's Supper after the service, we're going to stay here, and we're going to eat lunch together. So bring your side dishes, dessert, entree, whatever it is. Bring food. We Covenant Presbyterian Church, through your tithes and offerings, we provide some food for that as well, for the lunch, and then we get it all together, and we eat. So you're invited for that. Stay. Come worship God with us. Eat the Lord's Supper, and then stay after for lunch. And just to continue to announce that we are going through a new members course every Sunday morning on Sunday school, and we're going to continue that through the end of August. If you ever want to join Covenant Presbyterian Church, you need to attend this course. Now, you've missed some days of this, but it's okay because there's a lot of repetition built into this, so you can miss a few and still get the whole effect of it. So that's for visitors. Now, if you are a member here, you should attend that too, because you've never seen me teach this course before. I've only been here 2 years, and I'm talking about the vision for our church. I'm talking about church membership, what other stuff means, and I'm talking about our vision for discipleship and what it means for people who join the church. You need to. You could attend that. You're invited. It's going to be profitable to you. And then I have the names of missionaries there in the worship guide, which are also something that you help support, and some of whom are here with us this morning. What a blessing. So let me pray for us in thanksgiving, and we are going to march towards conclusion. Heavenly Father, your Son told us that he is the only way, and right after that he also said that he is the vine and we are the branches, and that without him we can produce nothing. But through your Son and through his grace, Lord, we are producing. Our labors produce fruit, and you provide for us. Lord, our lives, we ask that they may continue to be fruitful Would you please have mercy on us and accept our gratitude for your care, for your fatherly care for us. Help us to be wise in everything we do at work and to use, Lord, the means, the financial means you provide for the expansion of your kingdom with wisdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us stand and sing the doxology. Face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you.